Hi guys, and welcome back to another IBRACORP video. Absolute pleasure to have you guys here today. Thank you for coming back and checking out the channel. Today we're looking at Wizarr. Now this is an interesting project, something that I think a lot of us Plex users would really enjoy, Plex administrators I should say, and helps answer a lot of the questions we have from our users on what is Plex, how do I get access to it. You know, once you invite someone, one of the things you notice is all of a sudden they have all these questions because they've never even used it before. And here on their GitHub, which you can clearly see here, so Wizarr and Wizarr, we come down and you can see some of the features that probably are going to appeal to you quite a lot. One is the automatic invitation to your Plex server. So it's going to handle that invitation part. It's going to handle a secured invitation environment. Plug and play single sign-on support. It's going to guide the user on how to download the Plex client. Now this is really, really cool because normally, you know, you'd have to ask for the email of the person, you know, tell them to create an account on Plex, give you that email so then you can invite them, then you explain to them how to use it. This is doing all that for us. It integrates with our request systems. So we've got Overseer and Ombi listed here as examples. It has Discord server integration as well, so we can invite users in Discord, and it's customizable. Now, I don't know about you guys, but that says a lot to me and is actually very, very interesting. Something I'm pretty keen on giving a go. I'm gonna show you how to get this set up and running as well, but here's a couple of screenshots to give us an idea what it's gonna look like. So we've got our quick invite thing here. Scroll down a little further, and we have some other windows as well. And you know how to basically join the Plex server listed here in the screenshot. So if you're interested in this project, as usual, I ask our supporters and our members to go check out the project, do anything you can to help support it. If you like it, you know, give it a star, give it a share, you know, donate to them if they take donations, help these developers create these awesome apps for us that we get to enjoy. So with that all said and done, now let's just get into the installation and actually fire it up ourselves and see how we go. Okay, so here we are in Termius, our terminal application, and we're on our LXC container that runs all of our media apps. So if I go docker ps here, you can see all of our media apps running on here. We've got Radar, Sonar, Prowler, all that kind of good stuff all happening there. And it's all stuff we've covered in our previous videos before, so feel free to just search our channel followed by, you know, the name of the app, and you'll probably find one of our videos on it. Now, the first thing I want to do is create a folder for this installation. Now, all my apps on this server are stored under the /opt folder or opt. If I just go to cd/opt and I go ls, you'll find all of our folders here. So what I'm going to do then is make a directory and call it Wizarr. Then I'm going to go into that folder. And we know that that folder is now empty, of course. Now going back to the instructions, if we just have a look here, they actually have a docs page for us to follow, which is excellent. Now, obviously I'm gonna show you this in the video, so I'm not gonna go through and show the steps on the screen, but feel free to follow along because this is what we're gonna be following. So big props to the developer for creating a nice, easy to read documentation. We love that. I'll also drop a link in the description below for you so that you can follow along. Now, pretty straightforward, what we're using here is Docker Compose. If you've never used Docker Compose, we have a guide on how to use Docker Compose and the benefits of doing so. Now, one of the benefits is, of course, it gives us such an easy way to get it fired up, as you can see here. So basically, copy this config, and we're gonna go into our code server. You don't have to do this with code server, you can just create a Docker Compose file on your terminal if you like. Which I'll show you now as well. So here we are in the folder, and we'll just say nano docker-compose.yml. We'll paste this in here, control O and control X. Now if I go ls, we can see we've created that file. But I like to work in code server, which again, we've done a video on code server and its benefits, but I'll bring that over for you to have a look now as well. So here we are on code server, and if you haven't used it before, it has recently been updated, which is fantastic. The developers actually reached out to us in our Discord to let us know about some really cool features coming this way. So I highly recommend you guys check it out. And by the way, I'm not a developer. I'm definitely not showing you everything that this app can possibly do, which is a lot. But for the basic user that doesn't need to be a developer, it also provides you some really cool options. So here you can see our opt folder, and underneath is the Wizarr. Let's open up that Docker Compose file. And now that we're here, we can start working with this file. Now, in terms of configuration, there isn't too much that will throw us off. So we have our container name, which is Wizarr. We have our ports, which it wants to open at 5690, and our volume. Now, obviously the volume is a placeholder, so make sure you update this. Now, what I like to do is with my, and this is again, my personal opinion, I like to just put in this as the field. Now, what this does is says, whatever folder this compose file is being run, that's where we'll create this subfolder called config, which is perfect because it's already in a folder called Wizarr. So I don't have to type in an entire path, set path. So then the benefit of that is if we move to another server and we have a different layout, we have different folder structure, that doesn't matter. It'll just create that subfolder wherever this file lives. Now, what we can do is create a URL as well. It wants a URL that is going to be what you give to people. Now, for us and our purposes, I don't know if I want to go with wizarr.domain.com. So what I might do is just give that a different name. So I'm going to call it onboard.domain.com. Now, in my case, guys, I'm going to change this off screen to my actual domain name. So don't put in domain.com, put in your domain name. Now, again, we have this disable built-in auth. Now, if we are hiding behind something like Authelia, which we've done videos on, Authentic, also done a video on, then we probably don't want to have another sign-in being presented by Wizarr. We can say our sign-ins are controlled by those authenticators, so we can turn that off. But in our case, this is not going to be the case, so I'm going to leave it as false so that it is authenticated. And then I've set my time zone here as well, as you can see, and we hit Control Save, and we're done. Now, in my case, I actually have a couple of extra settings. These are things I've explained in our Docker Compose video, but we basically use a custom Docker network, and that means that we have to be ready to call that network for the container. So in our case, that network is just called proxy. If I just come here and I drop this underneath. Okay, so we're saying, I want you to live on this network called proxy, and we're identifying what that network is, which is a bridge, and we're saving that. Now, if I compare that to one of my other containers, I can see that, yeah, there's nothing else I probably need to put in there. One useful one that you probably would want is perhaps the restart command. So we say we always want it to restart. So if I go to Tortuli, for example, you can see this one says unless stopped. So again, perfectly good option. You can just change that to unless stopped. Otherwise, always restart it. So if the container fails, just restart. That's what we want. We want it to be online all the time. Now, one final thing I will also add is our labels for traffic, and that is so traffic can reverse proxy this for us out to the web. So as you can see, we've got the app URL here for the app itself, which it needs, but for the labels for traffic, we've added those now, making sure we've updated them with the name of the app, or at least a unique identifier, and the URL that we want that to go to. Again, I'm going to be putting my own custom URL in here, but for the purposes of this demo, I'm just showing you domain.com. Make sure you update that to yours. And basically with all that done, we make sure it's saved and we're pretty much done here. Now, if we come back to our terminal and we go to that folder, we say ls and we can see that file is there. So what we need to do then is docker compose up. And for the first run, I'm actually not going to put the hyphen D, which says we want to detach it. I actually want to see the logs live, so I'm just going to say docker compose up. So it's pulling the container down. That's a good sign for us. That means that it's obviously working and it started the container. So let's see if we can get to the website externally, since we have the reverse proxy up and running. Let's see if we can get to it directly externally now. Okay, so I've typed in our website that we configured to say that's where we want Wizarr to be hosted from. And here we are, with the first screen we see is the setup screen. So let's go ahead and do that. Okay, we've got our details, click on create an account. Now it's asking us to create a display name. I'll just call it Wizarr, that's fine. And it's asking for our Plex URL. So let's go ahead and put that in. And we need to also put in our Plex token. Now, if you don't know how to get your Plex token, go to your library, preferably go via the URL that you're actually going to be using and putting into Wizarr, and find an item. So here's an individual item here. As you can see, I'm a big fan of Seinfeld. I absolutely love Seinfeld. So if we go to get info, view the XML. Now, right at the end, there'll be a Plex token right here. Copy that and put that into Wizarr. So you should have something that looks a little like this. Obviously, I've just got a placeholder here and a placeholder here. We've put our overseer address that we send people to when they want to request content. And we've also got our Plex token and Plex URL. Now, I'm going to update those to the correct ones. I'm not going to be using the Discord integration for myself, but that option is there for you guys and it's well documented in their documentation. So I'm going to put all that in and then I'm going to click scan for libraries. So I can confirm after hitting scan for libraries, it actually did bring up those libraries and that means it connected to Plex. So that's happy days. So basically I just click next after that and it takes us back to the login screen. Now here we are on the login screen, go ahead and click sign in. And here we are. So now this is us actually logged in and working. So as an admin, we can go through to settings and that will allow you to change things like your Plex URL and token and things like that. Then have our users, which pulls in the whole list of your current Plex users and I guess anyone else you've invited. And here we are on the quick invite. So this is optional. We can either put one in or it will just generate one for us. And we can set one up with an expiration or not. So let's say 1 week. And we won't put unlimited, we'll just click create. So I've copied that link and I've opened it up in an incognito tab. And this is what I'm presented with. Basically tells us we've been invited to join the Wizarr server. Now I assume that's the part that we could update to something else. And it gives us our invite code and we can just click on join. So what it does then is it launches Plex. Now once we've signed in with Plex, it takes us back to here automatically and it says join and download Plex for this device. So it says, great news, you now have access to our server's media collection. So in the background, it's joined the user to our Plex server. And now it says, you know, let's make sure that you know how to use it with Plex. So if you plan on using it on this device, it gives you the option to download the app, which is great. I already have the app, so let's click next. Now it'll say, we're excited to offer you a wide selection of media to choose from. Because we've put in our overseer or our request system, now it gives people this option. You can request any available movie or TV show, blah, blah, blah. We already know what that is, but this is for a fresh person who may not be familiar. Now, if they wanted to open that, they could just go ahead and click check it out. And there you go, it's taken them to our overseer site. That's fantastic. I can't tell you guys how many times I've had to tell people how to do this stuff. So back here again, they've come back, they've checked out what Plex request is, they click next, and they end up on this final page. So what is Plex? Great question, gives you a little bit of an explanation. How do I watch stuff? Also there. And how can I make sure I get the best experience? Now this one is huge because the amount of people that will start and your server is working its butt off transcoding, this sort of information is so helpful for new users. So here it is, it's got a complete explanation and a short video on how to set the best quality settings. You know, maybe everyone has a personal preference, but for the general population, I think you'd probably agree it's not too bad by setting their quality to maximum and some other stuff. And yeah, both options, one for the browser and one for using it on the apps. And there you go, that's done. So now they can basically use Plex. It's automated the entire process for us and we're happy with that outcome. So guys, that's Wizarr. It's done, it's easy. I mean, we got it set up in less than probably 10 minutes and it uses absolutely no resources whatsoever, which means, you know, it's not hard to just keep it running 24/7 if we had to. Now, the best part, of course, is once the person is in Plex, I mean, if all else fails and the app decides to die, there has no impact on your Plex instance or your server or your users. It's just gonna impact those you're trying to invite as new members. And that's something that you can already do manually via Plex anyway, so it's not a big loss. This is an enhancement as I see it. And the fact that they've thought of these extra little bits to help people with settings and how to get the best out of their setup, that's what makes it gold for me. So I'm definitely going to be using it for people that want to join my Plex server. I suggest you guys at least give it a try and see what you think. Give some feedback to the crew, the developers, and hopefully it does what you want it to do. If you have anything you want to add, drop it in the comments below. Be sure to like and subscribe as usual. We really appreciate that. And I hope you guys have a great day. Thanks again. We'll see you in the next IBRACORP video.